Welcome to the Real Joseph Lamtman. I am Lamtman. Happy Monday to you guys. Welcome back to the Real. New here, subscribe, hit that like button on the way in. I appreciate that. Share this content. If you've been a subscriber of mine or following my content, welcome back. I appreciate you guys. Happy Monday. As you can see out the window here, we got a little snow and a little cold today.
It's all good.
It is very
calm though, looking out the window here and watching this. It's
very peaceful. But yeah, happy Monday to you guys. Hope you guys get ready for this week. First off, before I get to today's show, I want to give a shout out to my man Jonah Moore. Grew up with him in Chicago Falls. Joe and I played baseball together. We used to train together at Hit and Run Baseball Academy from the area. You remember they used to be around with people used to own at the Pences, good family friends of mine, Jim Gleisner, trainer. Jonah lives out in Cali now, and he actually, let me make sure I got this right. I think this is, yeah. Made this for here. He sells these online. He hit me up and said, hey man, I got these. This is spray paint art by Jonah. That's really cool. And so you had to get one for my man, support him. And so I'm going to link his Facebook below. I think he's still selling. He has a bunch of these he's still selling. He's going to start selling them out. Pretty cool. So go support my man. Jonah, shout out to you. Hope all is well. Good talk to you again. Appreciate the painting. But yeah, so on today's show, me, my man, Mike Antonace is going to join the show. We're going to give a recap of championship weekend. Primarily the Bengals-Chiefs game. I'll be honest, I really didn't watch the the Eagles-49ers game. Glad I didn't either because it wasn't really much to watch. It would have been just a three-hour nap, really. But the Bengals-Chiefs game, that's the one everybody's talking about today. Everybody knew that was the game going into the weekend. Yeah, and I got some thoughts on that game. I'm going to give my quick recap of the game from my perspective. Some key things I saw. Then I'm going to bring my man Mike up here. We'll get his take on it. So, yeah, without further ado, give me 1 second. If I find it here. Okay, hold on. Okay, there we go. All right. Sorry, guys. I had to get the right thing up here. But, so, yeah, let's get to it. My take on the game. Number one, the game started off bad for Joe Burrow. That offensive line was not very good for the Chiefs at all. For the Bengals, rather. Defensive line for the Chiefs completely wrecked that game yesterday. Chris Jones was on one. Maybe the best defensive lineman in football right now, and if Tony Romo said he was. I just feel like yesterday's game, to me, it started off bad for the Bengals from the get-go because they were getting the Joe Burrow all day long. I think they had 4 sacks within the first quarter, I think it was, right, definitely before halftime. That's too much. So it wasn't a good sign from that point. I just feel like yesterday wasn't a good Joe Burrow game. He made some bad throws at the end of the game. I thought the interceptions were not good interceptions, throwing them in the one. Threw a deep ball. He had some pressure in his face. Got picked off. That wasn't before the half. The one in the second half, though, the crucial drive in the game, he throws it deep in the double coverage. He gets picked off. Not a good throw there. But I feel like yesterday, Joe Burrow cannot get a rhythm going just because the offensive line couldn't protect him. And it just could. I mean, he had some nice drives, but for the most part of the game, Chris Jones. And that front seven, what Steve Spagnuolo was dialing up, was just too much for the majority of the game. And then, that leads to my next point. Everybody's wondering out all week, how's Patrick Mahomes going to work? He had the high ankle sprain on his back foot, his right foot, his throwing foot. He platforms off of. I thought Andy Reid yesterday, and I'm going to get to Andy Reid here in a minute, because I think what Andy Reid did yesterday was phenomenal. Helping out his quarterback, but Patrick Mahomes yesterday was still great on that back, even on a bum ankle. He had the one bad play. He had two bad plays. He had the one throw, which really wasn't his fault because of the injury. Couldn't really step into it, and then he had the botched fumble. He was trying to throw a quick screen to the right, fumbled the ball. But I thought yesterday Patrick Mahomes was pretty damn good. I thought that was a legacy game for him. Which is kind of like during the week. I know early in the week I was leaning towards the Bengals. And as the week went on, Cincinnati's doing a lot of talking. And Mahomes is like the underdog, like a big underdog. Everybody was doubting him, like, is he even going to play? How effective will he be? All this. I'm kind of like, man, Mahomes is playing with house money in this game. And that's what he looked like yesterday. He looked free still. He just typical Patrick Mahomes. And what I was most impressed with Mahomes yesterday was, despite the circumstances, he had a bum ankle. And you know, he had that going on. But also, he had three receivers go out in the middle of the game. He had Mecole Hardman go out. He had Juju Smith-Schuster go out. And I think there was one more that went out. But those were two main receivers. At one point in the end of the game, I think they only had three active receivers playing. It was Sky Moore, Pacheco, who's the seventh rounder out of Rutgers they drafted last year. And Sky Moore is a rookie as well. And then Valquez Scanlon, I think is his name. He's turned into a pretty solid player in the league and fitted really well with them. He spent most of his career before Kansas City with the Packers. Had a great game yesterday. He was unbelievable. But not a whole lot going on. And you know, Travis Kelce's getting double, triple teamed the whole game. And yet again, Mahomes was still able to make the plays, still able to use his, you know, use his feet even at the end of the game, which we'll get to that in a second on a controversial, or not a controversial call, but a, the next slide. This is the controversial call we're talking about. And so I get everybody's talking about this today. This is in the, I think the fourth quarter, about 10 minutes left. And it's third down, right? And so Mahomes goes third down and it's incomplete pass. All of a sudden the referee comes running in, everybody's seen it, and they're saying, okay, we got to wave this off because they said the referee there with the black cap on, the head referee there with the white cap, his name is Ron Torver. They say. I looked it up here. Yeah, Ron Torver. But the back judge on the back end of the field, right there, it says 45 on his shirt. He blew the play dead, and all of a sudden, here comes the referee. We think Kansas City's coming out to punt. And not only are they coming out to punt, they got 10 seconds left on the clock to punt. And everybody's, okay, what the hell's going on? And then all of a sudden, it's, okay, we got to, the play was dead. We got to reset the play. We got to redo the whole play. Here comes Kansas City's offense. Tony Romo's like, and Jim Nantz like, okay, they're going for it on fourth down. That's what everybody thought. No, we're just going to redo the play. And I thought, I was talking, there's people that have watched the NFL for years, a lot longer than I have. I've never seen that ever. How much did it affect the game? I don't know. I mean, because Kansas City was able to get the first down, so they eventually did punt, but it did pin back Cincinnati more. Because if they would have punted from the original spot, they would have a little better field position. But again, just a bizarre point of the game, and that's what everybody's talking about today, and I'm going to get my man Mike's take on it. I don't know. I was surprised. I was just shaking my head when I couldn't believe what I watched. I was just kind of like, okay. This one, you just blow a play. Now, they said it's really loud. It was so loud in that stadium yesterday, nobody heard the referee's whistle. But every other play after that, I paid attention. You could hear the referee's whistle every time they blew it. So I'm a little confused with that, like everybody else. But to me, obviously, the call that, or the one play that I was getting to earlier, I think Joseph Osai, I think is his last name, linebacker for the Bengals here. The Chiefs, first off, I never remember everybody's ripping into this guy today, and it was a bad play, obviously. Everybody knows you got to pull up when you've got the quarterback's head towards the sideline. You can't touch him, nothing. This is what happens. And he gets the late penalty call, personal foul out of bounds, sets Kansas City up 15 more yards for the Harrison Butker game-winning field goal with 8 seconds left. But I think the play before that, the punt return by Sky Moore, I don't know, how in the hell do you let this guy return that punt all the way out to the 50? To me, that was the play that was kind of like, I don't know who the special teams coordinator is for Cincinnati, but that was not a good, you're at a crucial point in the game, a crucial play. You gotta, it's an easy play too, you do, so you have to pin them back. And this dude runs right up the sideline, Scott Free gets the 50. And so you're already in trouble. You gave Mahomes midfield with ample time left. I mean, we saw him win a game last year with 13 seconds. So, to me, I thought yesterday, my biggest takeaway from the game yesterday, ultimately, was Andy Reid and the Chiefs just completely outcoached Cincinnati Bengals, in my opinion. I thought Andy Reid and his the enemy, Steve Spagnuolo, from start to finish, I think that they just completely, they were just a step ahead of the Chiefs, or excuse me, the Bengals, the whole game. I thought that Andy Reid's coaching yesterday, I thought he outcoached Zach Taylor and that staff. Now, I did think that the Cincinnati defensive coordinator, I thought, did a nice job in the second half, making adjustments. But I just, again, from start to finish, and just like the Bengals didn't make the little plays, the Chiefs did. You know, it's like the one Joe Burrow's rolled out of the third quarter. I think it was the second or third quarter. Would have been a big first down if they would have converted it. And the player from the Chiefs jumps up, tips the ball, and stops the throw from getting to the receiver. You know, little things like that to win the game. And I thought you saw that yesterday. I think you see why the Chiefs have been as good as they are. I thought, like I said, I thought Andy Reid did a hell of a job protecting his quarterback with the injury, setting him up, putting him in good spots. I mean, just, that system's unreal. I mean, and Steve Spagnuolo, I thought, did a great job, especially getting Chris Jones one-on-ones with the scheme. Again, I just thought they completely – I thought the coaching yesterday for the Chiefs and that just the coaching, the system, the culture is why they won the game ultimately. Could be my point to the refereeing, but I just think you look at the game from totality, from start to finish, the Chiefs just did more. They did more little things better, in my opinion. I know people are going to be talking about the controversial calls today, but again, it's plays like this, hitting guys out of bounds, you know, and just, you could see it all throughout the week, the talking, calling it Burrowhead. You know, they were calling the stadium Burrowhead. You got the mayor of Cincinnati coming out making declarations and all this stuff. You're just kind of like, you're giving them a lot of fuel. You're giving a lot of fuel here. And they used the ammunition, for sure. And that's why after the game, you heard Travis Kelce. And, you know, Travis Kelce made sure after the game to let the Cincinnati mayor have it. And I got that clip right here. Let me pull that up. 1 second. Hold on. It's in my ear. Where is it? Okay. There we go. Yeah. Here's a clip here from Travis Kelce after the game. Talks about Arrowhead, and he also talks about Cincinnati Mayor.
Woo! Arrowhead my ass! Woo! It's my home's house! Hey! I appreciate wise words for that Cincinnati mayor. Know your role and shut your mouth, you jabroni.
Yeah. Know your role and shut your mouth, you jabroni, was the quote from Travis Kelce. So clearly, the Chiefs, they were taking notes all week. And again, I think yesterday was a big testament to Andy Reid more than anybody. And Patrick Mahomes as well. Patrick Mahomes was unreal yesterday. He took the opportunity. Everybody was putting Burrow up against him. Same. A lot of people had Burrow ahead of him last week. You listen to talk all week. Yeah, I thought Mahomes came out there with that legacy game. So, you know what? I don't care about the ankle. I'll show you what I can still do. And he did it. But again, I think Andy Reid, what he's been able to do the last 5 years now, whatever it is, has been unbelievable. And just really his whole career, he's been a great coach. But I thought yesterday was, I was most impressed with Andy Reid more than anybody. And so that was my take from yesterday's game. Just a little brief, quick takes. Again, shout out to Mahomes and Andy Reid, big legacy games. So joining me now, if I get him on the right screen, there we go. Mike, welcome
What's
back
up?
To the Real.
Thank you for having me as always.
I guess we'll start here. What was your initial takeaways from yesterday's game before we break down? We'll dive a little deeper into it.
My initial take was Mahomes is still probably the most talented quarterback in the NFL right now. They compensated for his ankle. You could tell that he didn't have a whole lot of burst. He was trying not to move around too much. They were keeping him in the pocket, and he was getting the ball out quickly. And, you know, as the game progressed, I mean, Mecole Hardman, Juju Smith-Schuster, and I think it's Justin Gray was the third guy that was out. It wasn't Justin Gray. He was out there. Kadarius Toney was the third guy that was out. So they lost three receivers, and he was still able to make the plays. MVS had, I think, was well over 100 yards and a touchdown during the game. He was and he's always been like a really underrated receiver. He was like the big play guy in Green Bay before he got traded. Or
really smart too.
Really smart receiver. I've always really liked MVS.
Fits he's like perfect there.
Right. He's like a DJ Chark guy, just an underrated guy, but super productive when utilized within the slot. Speedy, can get separation. But yeah, neither team could run the ball well. And eventually, you know, Joe Burrow, as talented as he is, at the end of the day, I know last year he was sacked a million times in the playoffs by every team, but like eventually it gets to you and it can mess you up. I mean, the defensive scheme that Kansas City put together was excellent, and they lost Sneed, their best corner, within the first three possessions, I think, of Cincinnati having it. But I mean, they were moving Chris Jones around, they were moving him on different guards, they were moving him on the outside, they were taking advantage of their beat up offensive line. I mean, Lael Collins is out, Jonah Williams is out too, so two of their starting tackles are out, and then they had one of the right guard, I can't remember his name, but he was also out. And you know, that's already a weak offensive line outside of Lael Collins. Actually, I think their left tackle performed better than Jonah Williams has performed all season. And unfortunately, the Bengals just do not do well against elite defensive talent. They never have. They never will. Apologies, my dogs are freaking out. Yeah, there it is right there, that play. That I don't know why that's very
– Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, I don't know why that's a play that's like what's the word I'm looking for? Like controversial.
Emphasize as much.
Yeah, because he was 5 feet out in like out of bounds, and Joseph Osai pushed him and it, you know, tackled him more or less. And I mean, that's going to get called 10 times out of 10.
Here's the play right here.
Okay, yeah. I'll keep you could clearly see where he is in that right here. That slow-mo. Like, yeah, he's 5 feet out of bounds. That's going to be called every single time. And here, even still, if that's not called, he's still past midfield, picks up the first down, and has time to run the play. Need like 6 yards. But
and that's what I think. I think the botch punt more than anything, the punt return coverage, I thought.
Yeah, the fact awful. That they let Sky Moore do that to them, especially considering Sky Moore has had special teams problems all year. I'm glad I don't work for the Browns front office, because I actually really liked him coming out of college, and I thought he could be an option for the Browns in the second round, and he was picked in the second round. However, you know, he isn't very good at separating. He's not a very good route runner, so they had him returning punts, and he's had fumble problems all year. He's lost, I think, a total of 5 fumbles throughout the year. So they put that ball in Sky Moore's hands. And, you know, to his credit, he took it out to the 50. So good for Sky Moore. That's a big moment for that rookie. But
I thought, too. I mean, I get here. The Osai play was bad. Obviously, you can't make that play. But
right.
And obviously, it set up the game-winning field goal. But I just think, too, before that, you got to look at the totality of the game. But like I said, 2 plays before that, how do you get the punt return coverage was terrible. I mean, the guy
bad.
He was untouched all the way up the sideline to the 50. That was bad. And then I thought, too, I just thought, like I said, I thought Andy Reid yesterday, to me, Mike, Andy Reid was the biggest MVP of the game.
Oh, yeah. And here, I've never been Zach Taylor guy. I think Zach Taylor is an average coach who has well above average talent on his team. You know, I think Lou Anarumo is a pretty good defensive coordinator, and he's actually got an interview for the Cardinals head coaching gig this week. And that just came out of left field. The Cardinals coaching search is weird. What they're doing is weird, but that's neither here nor there. Anyway.
Mm-hmm.
The Bengals just really couldn't get, you know, again, neither team could run the ball well or effectively. Burrow was thrown off rhythm all game, got sacked a bunch, 2 turnovers, and One of which was a tip, which is usually like how Burrow like turnover happens. But one was just like pressure in his face and he threw the ball, you know, like to the wrong spot and was late. So one pick was actually really much on Joe Burrow. You know, I know they lose Tyler Boyd, I think in the second half, but, or no, early in the first half. But still, I mean, he has so much talent around him. You have Ja'Marr Chase, who's getting double teamed most of the time, but really he wasn't throwing 50-50 balls up for T. Higgins, who's one of the best position receivers who could be a one on so many teams, who has that size and speed advantage on so many guys, and he wasn't throwing it. He wasn't, you know, he wasn't throwing to the tight ends much. I mean, they weren't.
He just didn't have time either. I just felt like he could never.
Yeah,
the offensive line, and it was from start to finish. I mean, you could see it at the beginning of the first drive. It was just.
Right.
Boom, boom, and Chris Jones was unblockable yesterday.
And and again, that the point of getting like them out coaching the Bengals. I mean, the Bengals, you know, failed to adjust in a certain way. They didn't get the screen game going or quick, easy yards that you could get to put the defense in uncomfortable positions. You know, with all that pressure in Burrow's face, there were things to do, and the screen game was working, and they kind of moved away from it in the second half, which is where I think they needed it the most. But yeah, and it's going to be rough for the Bengals in the offseason, you know, which is I'm happy to hear as a Browns fan. But I mean, their whole secondary is going to be reshaped. They Von Bell's a free agent. Jesse Bates, the big free agent, who's, you know, very, very talented free safety prospect for a lot of teams, and he wants paid, and somebody's going to pay him. Von Bell's a good, you know, box safety. Somebody can probably pick him up, or is like a nickel option. Trey Flowers is gone. Jermaine Pratt is gone, and he played pretty well yesterday. He's one of the leading tacklers on the Bengals. Bengals have a lot to work through, and then obviously you're going into the fourth year of Joe Burrow. So you got to work out that contract, which I don't even begin to know what that's going to look like. You guys
know how the payroll is down there.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you got after this year, T. Higgins is going to be up for a contract. And I think he was a second round pick, if not, I'm not mistaken. So there's no fifth year available.
Eventually
for him.
You got Ja'Marr Chase. Eventually.
Yeah. You're going to pay Burrow and Ja'Marr, and then you're going to have to redraft everybody. I don't know when Boyd was drafted, but. It's going to be rough goings in Cincinnati within the next year, especially if they lose Lou Anarumo. Because if Lou Anarumo goes anywhere, that's a big part. You know, he does a lot with a little. Like, their best defensive lineman is Trey Hendrickson, who is good on the Saints. Mm-hmm. He's not a star, but he's good. And then their best interior lineman is DJ Reader, who's getting a little bit up there in age.
And that's what failed them too, is their offensive line. You look at last year's Super Bowl. What was the game-winning play? It was Aaron. I mean, I know it's Aaron Donald, but got sacked in that game. The year before that, he got injured, but didn't have a good offensive line.
And it kind of harkens back to what Joe Burrow said when asked, "Why do you have so much problems with the Browns?" You know, he's only beaten us once, and that was at his house. Why do you have so many problems with the Browns? And our defense is usually bad, but. They do not do well against elite defensive linemen. You know, we obviously have Myles Garrett. He always struggles against the Steelers, but luckily the Steelers secondary outside of Minkah Fitzpatrick, trash. So, and then the Ravens, I'm sorry, just blitz all the time. So like, they just do not do well against elite offense or defensive linemen. And Chris Jones is one of the best. You know, obviously they lose to Aaron Donald and they have troubles with Myles Garrett. They have troubles with TJ Watt. They just, their left tackle situation is not great. You know, Jonah Williams ain't it.
You look at rushing yards too yesterday.
Oh yeah. Both teams are stopping.
Both teams struggle with that.
Really well. And that is Chris Jones's talent. And DJ Reader's talent. DJ Reader's probably one of the best defensive linemen to stop the run. I really, really like DJ Reader a lot. Obviously, he's kind of like forged in fire and sharpened because he plays in the AFC North against Nick Chubb, Najee Harris, and then the Ravens run game, Lamar Jackson, and whoever the hell else they're handing the ball off to. So DJ Reader is excellent against the run, always has been. He's just really good at like taking the double teams, you know, doing the little swim move under the blocks and getting to the running back, and you know, they just couldn't break anything. And
yeah, and I just think too, like we could say, I just the pressure from the start of the game, the guy could never catch
it. It was a defensive battle.
Every time he had to make a play, he had to step up in the. He had to do Joe heroic and go, you know, and do some crazy stuff. I mean, even the fourth down, they went for that was a heroic play. The bomb to Jamar Chase.
I was like rubbing my eyes. I was like, I hate him so much. I respect him. I respect him, but God, do I hate him.
The T. Higgins ball, a 50-50. But at the end of the game, though, I mean, I was surprised
to not see more of those. My
whole point is, so you get the drive at the end of the game, or towards the end of the game when they threw the interception. I think he was trying to hit Higgins, wasn't he? On the sideline, it was double coverage.
That was Jamar Chase.
Was it Chase? Whoever it was.
Yeah, it was Jamar Chase, and then their first round pick. I can't remember his name. It was their first round pick from this last year's draft, not this previous draft, but the previous one to that. But yeah, anyway,
I just think the difference in yesterday's game to me, ultimately, like I said, was the coach. I think Andy Reid did yesterday to help Patrick Mahomes on that bad ankle, and he got worse as the game went on with the ankle. He was limping at one point.
Right.
What Andy Reid was able to do yesterday, I thought, was just masterful. I thought him and Bieniemy, whatever the hell they did this week in that game plan, Spagnuolo, same thing. But again, I can't get enough. I just couldn't believe how good they protected him.
Right.
Only sacked three times. He was still able to get comfortable, find his rhythm. The play call in the beginning of the game was great.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it came down to battle of the coaching yesterday won the game, in my opinion. And you look at what Cincinnati all week, they were giving a lot of bulletin board material. A lot.
Yeah.
You're going to call a Burrow head, and you're going to have a mayor coming out giving a declaration and all this.
Our mayor wouldn't do that. Our mayor is a superstitious Browns fan like the rest of us.
He just don't say anything at all. The guys listen to this stuff. And then does it affect the game? No, but does it give ammunition? Yeah. You're calling Arrowhead Burrowhead.
Of course. And like players will use that. And if you lose, players are going to drag your name through the mud and just put salt in that wound. You know, Eli Apple's another free agent who nobody's going to pick up because everybody hates him.
That's the whole point, though. That's the point, and I'll finish with this, is you look at all the free agents they got coming up. You can't protect Joe Burrow, obviously.
And I don't think there's a lot of
– it's very hard to get back to that point.
And
you got Mahomes on a bad ankle at home. You're the favorite on the road.
I mean,
and they just gave so much ammunition all week.
Right. I mean, think about it. How many quarterbacks?
I talked to you by the end of the week. We called each other on the phone. I think we're texting. I was like, dude, I think Kansas City's going to win this game now just because I don't feel comfortable with what I'm seeing from Cincinnati. I don't like what I'm hearing. It's a little too much.
And, you know, there's a real long list of quarterbacks that have been to a Super Bowl, lost it, and never went back. I mean, talented guys, you know, Matt Ryan, Phil Rivers. I mean, you name it. Like, there's just a ton. I mean, did Donovan McNabb go to multiple? Or did he only go to the one and lose it?
He went to the one. I don't know if he went to another one.
Yeah, so Donovan McNabb, I think, is on that list. I mean, it's just Cam Newton, you know, like all these excellent.
Eli Manning went to two.
Eli Manning went both. Yeah, the Mannings both have two Super Bowls, but it's a hard road to get there, and especially, I mean, just within their own division. I mean, you think, you know, the Browns have been chosen by multiple NFL executives to be like the breakout team, like the Bengals were 2 years ago, this upcoming season, and obviously it's because of our roster, you know, full year with Deshaun getting more comfortable, and obviously adding, you know, positions of need, which I think the Browns are very much going to do. I think
Pittsburgh's still around. I mean, they look pretty good.
They'll always be competitive. You know, I think they're
but they're still, I think they're on the come up. I don't know what's going to happen to Baltimore.
They need another corner. I mean, the Deontay Johnson stuff is weird. It looks like he might be on his way out, so they'll probably need another receiver.
Yeah. I don't know what's going on in Baltimore. That's a whole nother thing. I don't know.
Lamar Jackson is a New York Jet.
I think he's a Falcon. But
or a Falcon. You know, I would love for him to be in the NFC, just away, as far away from us as possible. So,
let me ask you this, though. We'll close out on this game with this. Based on all we've said about Cincinnati, what they got coming up this offseason, do you think Joe Burrow will ever have a good shot again? Now, we know Joe Burrow is a great player. We know that. When you have Joe Burrow, you got a chance. But do you think he'll ever get close again to getting back to Super Bowl winning it based on the projection of the future right now?
I mean, they're going to have to figure out what they're doing on defense. If they have a bad defense, I think they're going to be
3 to 5 years. Can he get back there?
Maybe. I'm going to leave that a maybe. I think they're going to be a perennial playoff team. But I also think that for the Browns, I think the Ravens' time in the sun is kind of ending with the Lamar Jackson stuff. And then they have so many holes on their offense, just like, you know, two injury prone running backs. You have Mark Andrews, pretty much no one else. Their offensive line can be shaky. No receivers. Like,
and when I asked that, I'm not saying that about Joe Burrow. Joe Burrow is a phenomenal, maybe the best quarterback in football eventually, or you can make the argument.
No, you're talking about the Bengals, right?
Can the Bengals organization support him?
I'm not sure. You know, the Bengals are historically a cheap franchise. They just got like Gatorade in their facility. There was that whole like funny article written in the offseason, like after they got Joe Burrow, they finally started buying Gatorade. Like before, like players had to like fill up water bottles and like the water fountain.
An NFL franchise.
So yeah, and I think they just started building a practice facility, or this was recent, because they were using like a local high school's practice field to practice. So yeah, they're a cheap franchise. I think Joe Burrow will want to stay there. It's just a matter of, will they pay him? Because, you know, there are, even if you drafted a rookie quarterback and you're a franchise that drafted a rookie, Joe Burrow is that special of a player that you would mortgage a future just to trade for.
You have to pay him. You got
to. Oh yeah, you got to pay him. I don't know what that kind of contract. Joe Burrow might be the highest paid quarterback, as far as I know, because I mean he's worth it. I mean, you go from winning two games to, you know, going to a Super Bowl and then making back to back AFC Championship appearances. Like, he is, you know, obviously Jamar Chase is there too, but like, you know, he is like cornerstone of that franchise at this point. It's going to be interesting to see how they try and like push that, because I don't know. I mean, he hasn't really talked about money, but like, you know, neither did Lamar Jackson before this year. You know, like he was always like, go flock, you know, like he was always like the team first guy. And now he's like, where's my money? You going to give me my money? I'm a former MVP. Give me my money. I'm worth it. Give me my money. Where's my money?
Yeah, that's gonna be a big contract coming up. But
I wouldn't be surprised if he gets paid $55 million a year guaranteed, like somewhere. I wouldn't be surprised. He's worth every penny.
Amazon money's coming in, so the salary cap's going up. But I
think that if they go to the playoffs next year, I don't think they're gonna be nearly as competitive. And the Eagles, I'm saying the same thing. Because the Eagles, I think, are going to mop the floor with the Chiefs, if you ask me.
Really? So you're taking the Eagles?
I am taking the Eagles. The Chiefs have chinks in their armor. That Eagles defense looked just unstoppable against the Niners. And I know the Niners had a quarterback problem, like Brock Purdy went down, but still, I mean,
That's my problem with the Eagles, is if you look at their schedule throughout the year, you look at the playoff teams they play, and they're a great team, but have they played against a great what they're about to face in 2 weeks? Anything comparable at least?
I mean,
no.
I would say, like, I mean, they play Dallas twice a year. I mean, they're not the Chiefs by any stretch of the imagination, but Dallas has a very, you know, intense defense, runs really heavy tight end sets because, you know, Dak. I just don't know what that, you know, I think pressure's going to win it again. The Eagles are good at stopping the run. They're good at getting pressure. They can get pressure everywhere. You know, you have Javon Hargrave. They have Fletcher Cox. They have Brandon Graham. They have Hassan Reddick. I mean, they just have people everywhere. And then they can blitz with TJ Edwards, James Bradbury, and Darius Slayer. Excellent corners. Gardner Johnson's a great safety. I mean, they have names everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And that offense is super explosive. I mean, if they don't get the run game going, which is one of the best run games in the NFL right now with one of the best O-lines, you got A.J. Brown and Devontae Smith, Dallas Goedert. I don't think the Chiefs for once. I think they are, you know, if you want to stack up guns, like you ever hear that saying, like, oh, the guy who wins has the bigger gun, you know, like
roster for roster, they're better top to bottom.
Oh, easily. And like, yeah. They're rolling.
I'm going to go with the Chiefs, and here's for three reasons. Well, only one reason, but for 3 points. They got the better quarterback. They got the best defensive player, arguably in the league. So they got the best player on both sides of the ball, and they got the better coaching.
I would agree. They have the best.
After what I saw Andy Reid do yesterday, he's going against his former team. If you don't think he's going to have a better game plan for that? I mean, maybe.
I just don't.
I think the experience from I think they've been here before. This is their third Super Bowl in what last 4 years. I think the Chiefs will win by 10 points. I think Mahomes will be a lot healthier by then. He's got 2 weeks to get ready, even though he looked pretty good yesterday. They'll get the other guys healthy. I think him and then Chris Jones and just with Andy. I just think it would be too much. I think the experience and just again, they got the best player on both sides of the ball. I think that's what's going to win in the end.
I mean, I would agree they definitely have the better quarterback. And Chris Jones and Javon Hargrave, at least this year, are very neck and neck with that, right? I think the Eagles' O-line is much, much better. You know, you got Jason Kelce. Both their guards are great. They have an all-pro left tackle this year. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know. I can see – because you neutralize Chris Jones, which just the Bengals failed to do just because they didn't have the guys or the experience to do it. I mean, who else do you got to block? Frank Clark, who's good, but he's going up against a third-string left tackle.
The Chiefs, though, they're just – I mean, who was the guy yesterday? McDuffie? Was that his name? Making plays? The rookie?
Oh, the corner?
Yeah, I mean, he was making – a rookie yeah. making – I mean, that's I like just who Trent they McDuffie. Are. I mean, that's just who they are. I mean, Sky Moore's making – I mean – Isaac Pacheco is a 7th-round pick, and he's become one of their key players so far.
Right.
I think from top to bottom, I think you could put them against anybody, and they'll find a way to win. Right. The way when you
I
come
get
off
you.
A win like when you come off a win like that, Mahomes is going to be healthier.
I just They're think it's a totally different offense too. I what you said about the Eagles playing somebody like the Chiefs. I don't think the Chiefs have played someone like the Eagles.
I don't know about that. I don't know if I trust the Eagles still.
If you want to say, have they played any? I mean, the 49ers had, you know, the best offensive defensive ranking in the NFL. You know, they're a tough team. And,
yeah,
you know,
they
dropped 31 on that defense.
They had Christian McCaffrey. I mean, you heard what George Kittle said after the game. Like, we didn't have a quarterback.
I understand
Christian McCaffrey was playing quarterback at one point. That was how bad it was.
But you're going up against that defense, you could still drop 31. You got, you know, Nick Bosa. I mean, you got Fred.
Devontae Smith, A.J. Brown, Miles. The way they can run the balls, they're probably the best running team in the league.
I think it's going to be a really good Super Bowl.
I like Jalen Hurts in college. I liked him in Alabama. I liked him in Oklahoma. Really good guy. But I just think when it's going to come down to key plays again, like this game yesterday. And I just think the Chiefs are going to make the key plays.
When do we find out who wins MVP? And who do you think it's going to be?
Oh no, that's the week of the Super Bowl. They do the award show, don't they?
Right.
I think it's that Saturday night. I think they do.
Because I know Jalen Hurts and Patrick Mahomes both got votes.
Who's the can? I don't know who the candidates are. I haven't looked. Let me look it up.
It's Jalen Hurts, Pat Mahomes, Justin Jefferson. I can't remember the fourth guy. Is it Josh Allen? No. Can't be Josh Allen.
Hold on, let me pull it up here. It's Mahomes, Hurts, Allen, Jefferson, Burrow, Nick Bosa. That's the six they got on this. This is SB Nation.
For MVP, Nick Bosa?
That's what I'm reading up top. I pulled it up here.
That's weird. I mean, Nick Bosa's good. He's not that good.
That's okay, so they just put out a list here. This is SB Nation. But it's Mahomes. I mean, it's Hurts, Allen, Jefferson, Burrow. Who would I go with? How many weeks did Jalen Hurts miss?
Like three, I think.
3 weeks. I don't know. I mean, who would you go with? I got to decide. I don't know. That's tough. I mean,
just based off of...
If
I mean,
out the regular season, just sustained success. I mean,
I'd probably go Pat. I know they don't want to give it to Pat, but like, I would give Jalen Hurts MIP like tomorrow, like most improved player. But
when you miss time, though, I think that hurts your.
Yeah, I mean, I think it helped him a little bit because the Eagles were much worse without him.
Yeah, sure.
So I think that maybe helps the argument, if anything. But
I think what the argument though with Pat Mahomes will have is. They traded their best receiver in the offseason.
Right.
Really revamped that whole side of the ball, really, if you think. I mean, the weapons didn't really miss a beat. I mean.
Right, and I thought they would. I thought they would struggle.
I thought yesterday's game on the one leg, to me, was all I needed to see.
I don't know. Maybe they – I don't know. Because if they decide after the Super Bowl and the Eagles win, I could see them giving it to Jalen Hurts, but –
I won't be mad if Hurts won it. I think he deserves it. Definitely deserves to be probably one or two, in my opinion.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure.
But, yeah, I would lean towards Mahomes. But, that's Mike and I's take on the game yesterday, the playoff picture as a whole, MVP. I know Mike had some other stuff he wanted to get into. This is kind of like a little freelance now for the rest of the show. Mike, what else is on your mind, buddy? I'll tell you real quick, though. I was kind of pissed off. You know, you had your Wendy's experience last week when you came on the show.
Mm-hmm.
I went to Panera Bread today, and I ordered a sandwich. And
were they lacking?
I wanted the sandwich the way I wanted it. You think they put everything on that? You think they got the sandwich right how I wanted it?
No.
They just put the meat in the bread, and that was it.
Are you serious?
Yeah. So, not a bad day at Panera Bread.
Bastards.
And as soon as it opened up, I thought of you with your Wendy's experience. You ordered a hamburger and they give you a chicken sandwich.
Yeah, they straight up gave me a chicken sandwich. I don't know how they could have done that. I'm still almost amazed. But, yeah.
It's just, you know, I got a topic too. I'm gonna hit on. Yeah, I it's funny. I was listening to Joey Diaz's podcast today. Joey Diaz, comedian, one of the things. He has his podcast.
I'm having a panic attack, Joe Rogan.
Yeah,
I ate a star of death on the app. I'm gonna eat another one.
Yeah, funniest man on the planet by far. But
love Joey Diaz.
I was listening to his podcast today, and every now and then I listen to it, just see what he says, and yeah, he made a hell of a point on there. And it's funny, I heard this before I ate my sandwich from Panera. And he talked about people, one thing the world lacks nowadays, when people, society lacks, is listening. Listeners. Observing. Paying attention. Like, listening to people. Nobody listens anymore. You can tell somebody something on a Monday, and you can call them the next day, or a Wednesday, and they'll totally forget about it. Yeah, they forget everything you tell. You can tell them to do one simple task, and they just forget about it. And it's funny, I opened up my sandwich, I'm just like, people really do not listen nowadays.
No.
You know, people do not listen. Everybody wants to do this kind of stuff. If you want to be a podcaster or you want to be successful and grow it in anything in life, this is a random thought, by the way. You got to be able to listen. People got to be able to observe. It's just amazing. I hear that he says that. Oh, I go and do something simple like this, making a sandwich. They couldn't even do that. Your dog could have made a sandwich better than those idiots.
He probably could, couldn't you, Molly? He's a good boy.
They could have made a sandwich better than those people. I don't want to call them idiots. Maybe they were busy.
But I mean, maybe he couldn't. I mean, look at that. I mean, he can't like make nothing. He ain't got no thumbs. Look, no thumbs.
But that's my observation. That's you want to call us the Monday observation.
Yeah. Start listening
anymore. Yeah. People need to start listening. Listen to people. Listen to and start talking to people. People don't talk anymore. They don't.
Right.
People are so scared now. It's just all these rules and bullshit and just, I don't know, man. That's my rant for today. What else is on? You got a rant that you want to give, or you want to add to that?
I mean, I agree. I mean, I can't relate for the not listening because, like, I don't know how much it was beaten into me when I was in sales to listen twice as much as I speak, mm-hmm. and then, like, that's how you would sell stuff, you know. So, I mean, I agree wholeheartedly. And I hope the Browns are listening to me when I say, give as much money that Daron Payne wants to him or Javon Hargrave. I'm happy with either or. If you can get either one, because the Eagles, another team that is going to have a lot of decisions to make after this year, because that defense, yes. Javon Hargrave, Daron Payne, one or the other. Let's go.
Don't bring us back that crap, the stuff from last year.
No.
You don't want that stuff.
No. Throw Tommy Togiai in the lake. Tommy Togiai, gone. Jordan Elliott, gone. Jordan Elliott, gone. I want them all gone. Perrion Winfrey can stay.
No, I don't need to do this every Sunday.
Yeah.
Snore.
Yeah, no, we need and hopefully, I don't think we cut JJ3. I was giving more thought to that. He's staying on the
board. I don't know. That's what everybody's saying. I know Jason Lloyd.
I don't think we cut him.
Covered it. They think they're getting the feel that they will move on from him. I don't know.
Really? Maybe. I really hope we don't spend money on a safety. Like, if we spend money on a safety and don't spend money on a tackle, I'm going to lose my shit.
Yeah, you have. Well, in this scheme, you got to have a tackle. I mean,
I know.
He's always.
That's why I'd lose my shit.
You got to get the air. You need to give me Payne. You need to get me, see if you can get DeForest Buckner from the Colts. You got to do something. They got to get creative.
Yeah. I mean, DeForest Buckner. That's, I would love DeForest Buckner on this team. He is such a talented player. I mean, just get him, Fletcher Cox, and like, if you want to keep poking from the corpse of the Eagles, TJ Edwards and linebacker. And then just draft a safety. I mean, there's a guy in the second that might be available. His name's Jamie Robinson from Florida State. He's a true free safety. And you can move on if you want. And then, like, or, I mean, we might move up. I mean, I really just don't know what the Browns are going to do in free agency because, like, we're linked to D-Hop and we're linked to all these different free agents. And we're, but then there's talk of us moving up in the draft because there's talk of these first round receivers dropping because no one thinks there's a true number one outside of maybe Jordan Addison. Like Jackson Smith and Jigba is getting a very low draft grade right now. And, for some reason.
If he drops, we can get him. I've actually seen a couple mocks of us trading with the Chargers like you sent to me to get him.
Yeah. And that's who we have to trade for. It's a low 20s pick. You know, they need a corner. And we have three outside corners. That's another thing. I'm like, what are we going to do? Because you can't. You're not going to put Denzel there. You just made him one of the highest paid corners in the NFL. He's one of the best man corners. That's the guy who covers the number one. Not going to put Martin in there. Martin's too big. He's like 6'2". Yeah, he's valuable. But he, like, again, just size wise, you wouldn't put him there. Like the only other guy you could put in the slot is Greg. You're not going to put him there because he doesn't want to play there anymore. He said so himself on Twitter. So like,
the
what do you do?
Although they didn't trade. They didn't give up Greg Newsom.
Really?
Yeah, they didn't give up Greg Newsom.
I mean, maybe we don't, but like...
It was a pick swap more than anything. But, I mean, here, what's his name? Todd McShay, he had Smith and Jigba drop him to, like, the second round. Which I think is lunacy, but...
I mean, maybe.
I think he's going to be... He's a high-volume receiver in the league that could be a number two, at least. I mean...
Yeah, maybe they think receiver is in the draft. Maybe, unless, like, if really they can't get D-Hop, because, I mean, if they feel like, if they're confident that they can move into the first to get, like, because I'd be happy with Jackson Smith and Jigba, but a name that I've started to watch a lot is Zay Flowers out of, I think he's Boston College.
Mm-hmm.
He is exactly what the doctor ordered for the Browns. Super fast slot receiver, just great ball awareness. You know, I think Jackson Smith and Jigba would do well in the slot.
I've seen Jalen Hyatt thrown in there.
Yeah, and that's if, like, you don't want to move in the first, because you could probably move up in the second, get Jalen Hyatt, you know, and because he's getting, like, a mid-second, early second kind of comp. I've seen some reporters say he could be, like, an early third-round pick. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know.
And I know why I say Jalen Hyatt is because the Tennessee connection.
I know. And maybe
and they were the reports about the air raid offense and all that. I don't know. Maybe it's true. Maybe it's not. But
I mean, yeah, we are.
They got to. I think defensive tackle. You just got to get some good defensive tackles. I think the wide receiver room is going to be a big. That's going to be a big emphasis. That's got to be the second outside of that, because you got to get not only you got to draft somebody. I think you got to get a couple of veterans up in here.
I don't know if we get a veteran, brother. I really don't.
They have to.
Maybe we get like a very not expensive veteran, like a Julio Jones on a vet deal. Yeah,
Campbell at least. Get somebody.
I don't think Paris is going to be here. Paris is going to look for a multi-year deal. If you know, the more I look at it, the more I'm like, okay, we're going to spend heavily in free agency on defense because we want to get. We want Jim Schwartz to have all the stuff he needs. And it's like offense was the better of the two units. And what do you got to do on offense? I mean, you signed everybody, right?
Well, that offense is going to be a little different next year. I mean, it's going to be somewhat the same.
We're going to be a pass first offense.
You're going to so you got Amari, you got DPJ.
And they love Amari. They're talking about, so they want to extend DPJ. They're talking about extending Amari because they love Amari.
Yeah, you got DPJ. David Bell will be back.
David Bell. I think Mike Woods is a potential cut.
Yeah, Mike Woods probably not going to be here, although he looked good in camp.
Anthony Schwartz might get cut.
Schwartz, cut.
He will be cut.
Yeah, he's might. Cut.
Because he may be
three. You need three more, so you got to draft one to me. Draft, so, and then
maybe we draft two. We draft multiple.
I think you draft one and you sign two. You got to do what the Chiefs did. You bring in a Marquez. Give me a Valdez Scantling and give me somebody with some speed.
DJ Chark.
Okay, give me. What if you drafted someone? Give me DJ Chark, and maybe. I mean, Mecole Hardman's gonna be on the market. I don't know.
Mecole Hardman wouldn't be bad, but
that's speed. I mean, you just need some speed.
Andrew Berry loves his draft picks, so I could see them maybe keeping Michael. Well, or because Dimitri Felton, I don't know if they're going to have him as a running back or as a receiver.
Now, what is he? I don't know. What are you? They didn't use him last year either.
I mean, they used him. He was out there. He not didn't get a lot of targets. But no, not as much as the first year. But I think
Michael Woods.
Yeah. The more I look at the Browns situation, actually sit down and look at it and see realistically how much cap they're probably going to free up, which is roughly $45 to $50 million. So you can sign maybe two big swings, two big guys, and then maybe a veteran or two. So two big guys, one big defensive tackle, either Javon Hargrave, you know, Daron Payne, somebody like that. Second, if you can do two big swings and you need a free safety, the more I see and the more I read, the more that Jesse Bates actually seems like he's actually on the Browns' radar. He wouldn't have to move far. He's familiar with the Browns. You know, it's the Bengals have left a bad taste in his mouth.
I think I like the Levante David as a possibility.
He would be a veteran. So, like, a cheap veteran would be a Levante David, would be a and he's not cheap. I say cheap in the fact that, you know, he's going to be a 1 year, 2 year deal, you know, with team options in the second year, probably $8 to $10 million is like cheap ish. Maybe they add a defensive end, but I could see the two big swings I really think are going to be D tackle, free safety. I could see them picking up another veteran defensive tackle, and maybe then they go linebacker or a like cheaper
receiver. I think they gotta get another veteran linebacker in there. I think
you gotta bring
in a new coordinator like this, you gotta bring in another one. I think a Levante David, you know, somebody like that, somebody that's one too would be ideal. Have them come in
You got options. There's a ton. There's a ton of, I mean, as far as the strongest free agent class for defensive tackle and the year we need defensive tackles and maybe a veteran linebacker and maybe a safety, it's the strongest free agency
I will say
for defensive tackles though, I've ever seen.
I've seen him mocked to the Browns. Some people have a first rounder. I think he is a first round talent. We've talked about him, Kalijah Kancey.
Yeah, I think he's starting to look a little bit more unrealistic because especially when the combine,
he's got to be a first rounder.
When the combine hits, I think his stock is going to rise a lot. Now that being said, I don't think for him. It depends what we do in free agency, and I really think we're going to go strong in the defensive tackle room.
I think they're going full swing for Deron Payne.
Yeah, Deron Payne or Javon Hargraves. I would be happy with either. I would be happy with either. Both had the same amount of sacks. I would prefer Deron Payne because he's younger. You know, you can get more out of him. Javon Hargraves isn't old by any means. I think he's 28, but like, you know, you're getting a 25-year-old Deron Payne coming off of a 12-sack season as an interior lineman. You know, it's kind of a no-brainer. But then I would pair him with a Fletcher Cox, Tier Tart. Shy Tuttle is another name to watch for like a good defensive tackle that's like doesn't get a whole lot of sacks but gets pressure. He's good at stopping the run and is just a good veteran. I think Shy Tuttle would be a good, like, cheap multi-year deal as well to pair next to him. He's out of the Saints. And then obviously Tier Tart from the Titans is another name to watch because, you know, obviously you have the familiarity with Schwartz there. But yeah, no, I think it's going to be DT and FS that they pay big money in free agency. Maybe they add a cheap receiver, but the more I read, man, the more I think we're going to trade up into the first. I'm not talking like early, but like I think they're going to try really hard to get like one of these first round like slot guys because like the two out of the three first round receivers I've seen.
Smith and Jigbo seems like an Andrew Berry pick.
He really does.
Didn't play last year.
He's a slot guy.
And the reason why he's falling is because he didn't play on outside because he didn't play last year. He didn't get to see him on the outside a lot.
When he didn't, and he didn't play outside ever. He was the slot guy. Yeah. But Andrew Berry, he's like, oh man, I can get 5 years of contract control and get exactly what we need.
I think he's so good. He's so good. His ball skills, his shiftiness, the way he gets, he's so consistent, smooth.
Yeah.
You can put that guy anywhere.
Yeah. The more I see it, man, I can see us.
Ball, let him go. The guy has 340 something yards. Mm-hmm. Against Utah, a pretty good defensive team. I mean,
because you trade Greg Newsom in a second to somebody who needs a corner and gets a second round pick for their first round pick, you take.
Maybe
you know,
draft another corner in the third
or
round.
Hell, I mean, depending on what the pick is, you know, if we can make that Chargers pick, realistically, you probably only have to give up a third and a player. So Greg Newsom and your 99th pick, keep your second if you can.
And if anybody can pick a
Andrew corner, Berry can figure it out.
he could pick a corner any point in the draft. I think he's proven that he can pick corners.
Yeah, so, and Martin really
Anderson should have been a first round pick, but
right. And he really, we just have to draft a slot corner, which you can find a great one in like the fifth round. Like you don't, you know, it's not a, you know, they never get paid. It's, you know, a very underrated, important role on the defense. So I really do think we trade. The more I look at it, Greg Newsom's probably getting traded. They fucking love Martin. They love Denzel. They're not going to get rid of either of those guys. And it's just easier to trade Greg Newsom. He's going into year three.
I think Martin's gonna be the best out of the three.
It's looking that way. I would happen to agree. He was the 10th best rookie out of the entire class last year.
Not many corners of that size, speed, and strength,
and that good as a third round pick, an absolute gem. Like this is why when people tell me like, oh, what picks has Andrew Berry picked that have been good? And I'm like, almost all of them. Like, what are you?
Well, I think some of them too, or you can't. I think some of them you can't really decide yet. I think he's got some misses and he's got some, but he's got a lot of good.
I mean, he definitely needs to hire a different DT scout for sure because his defensive tackle picks, Jordan Elliott, Tommy Togiano.
Jim Schwartz.
Perrion Winfrey looks okay, but like.
Jim Schwartz will be able to identify that. That's what he's always identified. But
thank God.
I know the Senior Bowl's this week, isn't it? I think it's.
It is this week. I'm excited for it. There are a lot of names to watch. A lot of names to watch. I mean, Josh Downs, the receiver out of South Carolina. I mean, Kalijah Kansey's going to be there. Byron Young out of Alabama, another name to watch. Mazi Smith out of Michigan, another defensive tackle prospect to watch. I mean, there's a lot. Jamie Robinson. I'd be excited to see what Jordan Battle does outside of from Alabama, the safety. The other safety who might get some snaps is Christopher Smith, who's going to be there from Georgia. I mean, again, that's just stating because I know safety is a small need. If we don't get it in free agency, that might be – we might have to look into the – for our 98th pick in the third round for a safety. Because I see us doing either a first to second round receiver. So that's going to be a receiver. Third round, depending on what we do in free agency, if we pick up a free safety and a D tackle – or multiple D tackles, that third round pick is going to be a tight end. Whoever's the best there. Is it Cade Stover? Is it Melvin Span Ford out of Maryland, who's another great pick? Does Darnell Johnson drop because his combine sucks? Because really, we just need a better tight end, too, to block.
I like the kid Wiley out of Cincinnati. I like him.
He'd probably be available in the later rounds, but I think they'll pick a tight end relatively high. Because they want they're picking for size. Because they're not going to do many two tight end sets, and we paid David Njoku, so we're not getting somebody to catch the ball much. Just a big body.
I agree, and I think I could see that getting somebody that can go for jump ball. I mean, although David's pretty good at it, but
David's great.
Yeah, I mean,
that's looking like a smart signing. I remember you and I were confused when that happened. Like, okay, well, I mean, I like David Njoku. I'm glad he's staying, but all that money? And then breaks out.
Some people hate it. Some people don't like
it. I thought it was a great signing.
I think it still needs to be determined. I want to see him. We're going to find out a lot. Now we got regular offseason, normal, everything. We never had. There hasn't been a normal offseason in a long time. So.
Yeah, poor Stefanski. He's had to deal with so much.
You finally got stability. You got your DC. You got your quarterback. Now it's time to roll. So it's
the biggest thing.
But, I think it's going to be an interesting offseason for sure.
Free agency starts next month, baby.
What else is going on at Mike's World? You got anything else going on? What's going on with you lately?
I'm just living life, working a lot, you know.
Worked down at the Daily Press?
At the Daily Press, you know. Just hanging out with my animals. It's been good, you know. We're doing our grand opening February 7th, if y'all want to come. We're in soft open mode. So grand opening is just a celebration, all that good stuff. You know, if you come, if you're one of the first 50 customers, you get a little tote bag with a mug and stuff. So. Yeah, if you want to come, you can. But
interesting since you've been doing this for almost a week now. Anything interesting happen when you've been there? Any customers have been interested?
Not really.
Nothing's popped off at the Daily Press yet.
No, that's the nice thing about being a cocktail lounge. It's like you know, all the drinks are expensive, so everybody's gonna behave. Look at this! Look at the dog, man. Look at him.
He's living life. Look at him. He's chilling.
He's just chilling. That's my chair.
Not anymore.
Who's your good boy?
What's anything else you want to hit on the way out? Or?
I think we covered
I'm going to ask you this. People might want to get to that. What's an interesting story about Mike Antonace we never heard?
I almost died in West Virginia when I was 17.
Really?
Yeah, we so I had this best friend in high school. His name was Dylan, and he moved to West Virginia with his grandparents. But we still talked all the time, me and my other best friend, who's still my best friend to this day. His name is Justin. We're like, well, we got to go visit Dylan. So my grandmother loved to play slots. And at the time, there wasn't – I think gambling was still illegal, right? Mm-hmm. So – she would go down to Mountaineer and play slots. So she was going down to West Virginia anyway. So she drops me and Justin down in West Virginia, and they had They lived on this big farm or like area, a house with a lot of land, and they had four wheelers, and they'd go on like these trails behind the property and all that good stuff. Well, they were doing a poker run to raise money for this local family to get a house, build a house, because they weren't doing too hot, right? So we do this poker run. I had been driving ATVs for legitimately like 3 days. Just learned how to work a clutch for 3 days. So we're driving these ATVs, and I'm going down this steep 60-foot maybe hill in fifth gear, which you're not supposed to do. You're supposed to go down low gears.
Yeah.
I did not know this. And, you know, it's a poker run. These trails don't have like guardrails or anything like that when you're driving. So there's a steep turn on the hill at the bottom. So I turn and I start screaming, like that. And I like, compensate because I could see the fucking thing almost flip. So I compensate real quick, and half of the ATV is like wedged on the cliff, like on like bramble, and like I'm tilted. I'm sitting like this, and I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to die. But it stops finally. And then my buddies are like, oh my God. And then like drive back up. Everybody just stops to look at me, and they're like, what gear were you in? And I was like, I don't know. And then I like, they were like, well, go down into neutral. So I go, and I hear five clicks, and they're like, Jesus Christ, you could have died. Ugh. So yeah, that's the story. And no, we did not tell anybody because for obvious reasons,
all right,
like we didn't want to ruin the time, but yeah, that's the story how I almost died in West Virginia when I was 17.
Wow. We did something on the show 2 weeks ago. I don't think you weren't on that night. It's not, you weren't able to make it on. And we, Corey and Jerry, my dad, they all gave the most interesting car there in car when they sold cars. The most interesting customer interaction they ever put out. And some of the interactions they were talking about was just unbelievable. Jeremy had some lady tell him she was going to cut him with a box cutter or something. Like, she pulled a box cutter out and showed it to him. She was going to stab him because he told her we can't return the car. Corey had some interesting ones. He had a customer say he's going to beat him up.
Oh, yeah.
My dad had a customer tell him he was going to bury him. What's the most, if you could think, what's the most, I know I'm putting you on the spot here. What's the most, I wanted to ask you this question. What's the most interesting customer interaction or sale you can remember?
I don't know if it's the most interesting, but it's the first thing that came to my mind. It was, and it's my fuck up, but I sold this very pretty young lady at the and her parents, Wrangler, her parents wanted to buy a Wrangler, and they came in on this cheapest Wrangler that we had on the lot. It was a stick shift soft top, like, you know, roll up windows, the whole nine. It was only like $33,000 for a Wrangler, right? Which cheap for a Jeep Wrangler, if you know the business. So we're going through the motions, and I sell the car, and, you know, think nothing of it, do the survey, blah, 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 blah. Months go by. This was in December. Months and months go by. March hits, and we had a heat wave, and I get a call into Tom's office. And they're sitting down, and they're like, hey, did you sell these customers a Wrangler? I was like, yeah. Yeah, I did. Why? And they're like, did you tell them it had AC? And I was like, I don't know, probably. I mean, all cars have AC. It's like, it's 2019. All new cars have AC.
Yeah, of course.
I mean, what
the hell's wrong with you?
Why are you asking? And they're like,
right.
Well, that Wrangler you sold didn't. And I was like, what? I was like, yeah, you're crazy. Of course it has AC. Everything has AC. And I'm like, you know, I'm a young dude. Like, I've never seen a car without AC. So they probably did ask. And I probably was like, of course. It's not a fucking Cavalier. You see this thing? Brand new. Kick the tires. Look at it. The thing's mint. And your dad actually is the one to defend me in the meetings because they wanted to rip my head off. And he was like, he probably didn't know. He probably was like, hey, you know, everything has AC. So
they didn't look when they were looking at it. I mean,
yeah, no, I mean, like, completely on me, but like, they came in, returned it after like 4 months because we had to, because it's my fault. And, We switched her out into basically the same thing with AC, and we made it work so it was the same payment. Mm-hmm. But like, that was the most interesting one because I was just like, I'd never felt more dumb, but I was like, well, what the hell? Like, yeah. like I feel like this isn't my fault.
All right, everything's got AC. What the hell are you talking about?
Yeah. It's like, what do you mean we ordered something without air conditioning? Like, what? I thought this was America. Like,
oh,
not
man.
Driving Fiats.
Right.
So, yeah, that wow. stands out to me.
Yeah.
They were nice people. They were understanding. They weren't mad or anything. They were just like, yeah, this thing don't got AC.
It's 2019. Of course got AC.
Yeah.
God. Oh, man. But,
does it have AC? Of course.
Well, I guess... When we get out, you got anything you want to ask me before you get out of here? Anything you want to? I'm always curious what's going on Mike's mind.
Do you think you're going to grow out the beard?
What do you mean grow out? Like how much?
Like this? Like do you have?
When I grow out like big? No, I would never grow it out that much.
Well, this ain't big. It's like
no, yeah. I'm not saying yours. Yours kind of identical. Mine's a little short. See, I can't like mine doesn't get. It's like up here as much, so.
Oh really? Yeah. You don't get like
not
that
as yeah. Yeah, yeah, I can, but not as much. Plus, I don't like it too bushy. I don't like a French fry hanging out. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
That's not for me. I like to look nice.
Dude, it seals in the flavor. It's great.
No, I like to keep it clean. You know, but no, I don't see that anytime soon. No.
I gotcha. Here's a good one. Do you think, like, because I know I was rambling about it, but do you think Greg Newsom's going to get traded? Because I don't know what we do with three outside corners.
I'm going to say yeah, because I think if Smith the Jigba drops, I think you have to make that deal, in my opinion. I think you have to – it's all more about Deshaun. You got to get Deshaun support.
Yeah.
You paid that kind of money. You got to go all in. I don't think you really need Greg Newsom, to be honest with you. I agree with you. I think he's a valuable player. I think he's a good player. He has a lot of upside still, but I just think the other two are better. And I just think you can get more corners somewhere else. I think you could draft a corner in the fourth round. I think you can draft a corner. Hell, you can draft one in the second round if you still have a pick there, if you trade out. I mean,
right,
you probably trade, but I mean, if you trade a three and like Newsom up into the one, you still have your second round. And you let's say you signed Deron Payne, I think you got a little more flexibility. You could take one there,
right?
Maybe take another Martin Emerson type. I think just I like more Martin Emerson gives him so much because of his size, and just I think that's more kind of what Jim Schwartz would want too, is more of a size corner, more of a. Somebody that's just hey, Martin Emerson. I mean,
right.
Know, size, speed, strength, length. I mean, all of it. I think you got to have the durability.
Right.
You're in the AFC North, so.
Yeah.
I don't think having two small guys that have been in and out of the lineup because of injury and then one durable guy, I don't think that's long term. You can't pay all that anyway. So.
Right.
You got one of them's already locked up. If I got to pick between the two, I'm taking Martin Emerson all day, every day.
Right.
I don't think it's even a debate.
We'll have to go to training camp this year. We're gonna.
Oh yeah.
We doing the draft party this year?
Oh yeah, yeah, for sure.
Good.
We might do. We might even live stream that.
Good, because I want to get Kronk.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah, because you came over for the COVID draft in Cleveland, wasn't it?
Yeah.
No, not the COVID draft. That wasn't the COVID draft. It was. I'm thinking of the one, the virtual one, in the year before. No, you came over for the one in Cleveland in 21.
It was
me, you, Corey, Jeremy showed up, and then. You surprised my dad with Rosado showing up.
I did. And then it was funny because, like, Corey's there, and he's like, please, give me Justin Fields, give me Justin Fields. And then they drafted Kyle Pitts, and he pretended to be happy about it.
Well, yeah, he was so, like, and I saw the pick on Twitter. You know, they tell you the picks sometimes before they even announce on your TV. Get it. And I looked down, I looked, okay, I saw it's Kyle Pitts, and I'm like this. I looked at you, and I'm like, and Corey's like this. He's, like, on his edge of his seat, like, is it going to please be Justin Fields? And I'm thinking, this poor bastard, he's about to get his, you know.
Yeah, he's about to get his world rocked.
Yeah, he did too. He was kind of like, oh, okay.
Like, yeah, he is. All right. Yeah. a moment of like, it's fine, I guess.
Yeah, it was like, damn. Like, he really wanted to say, fuck. And then he was really just kind of like, okay, he's a good player. Yeah. He's a good player.
Yeah, I hope he gets moves. Lamar Jackson. Me and you can both hope that. We're both hoping for Corey's team to get Lamar Jackson.
I think he is going to the Falcons, actually.
I hope so. Yeah, there's no part of me.
I think that owner's got to get somebody. They tried to go in last year for Deshaun. He's got to go all. He's got to get somebody down there.
Yeah.
Because they can't draft one.
They suck at drafting.
They can't sign another Mariota-type guy. They got to get somebody down there. And plus, you got that stadium. You know, you're in Atlanta's actually, it's like Hollywood of the South. It's a pretty good market. So,
yeah,
they got to get somebody down there. I think that's a great spot. I think that's the best spot for Lamar from marketability and everything, too.
All right, brother. I have to get cleaning or else my wife's going to kill me.
You got your book of the week, though, for you out here? You know, I got to ask you.
Let me see. Where did I put it? If I can actually get it out. It is a fat boy. I'm going to be reading this while. The Way of Kings by Brandon Sanderson.
Okay.
It is the start of the Stormlight Archive, which is his fantasy epic. Mm-hmm. It's really cool so far. It's about a world that basically there's a storm that travels all across the world, and it gives people powers.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really cool. A lot of world building. It's kind of a slow start. I'm like 200 pages in, but definitely worth a checkout. It's very popular.
All right, well, we'll get your review on it when you get done with it in your next book. So, all right, man, well, I'll talk to you later on. Obviously, thanks for coming on again. Mike's got to go get some cleaning done.
The wife will kill me.
Hannah's going to, you know, beat him up. So.
It's a knife. Yeah. I'll blink twice, so.
Yeah, we'll see if Mike comes back for another one. if he makes it. But, all right, man, well, I'll see you in the next one.
See you in the next one, brother. Thank you.
Peace. Thank you. All right. I want to thank Mike for coming on, like always. Just a random one for you guys today. We weren't able to do the Sunday Live yesterday because just the timing of the games went late and people had some stuff they had to do. So we'll get back to that Sunday, or eventually we'll do more of those weekend lives. We like doing those. We got to get some more people coming on too. So that'll be cool. Stay tuned for more of the episodes like this of The Real. I got some guests coming on. I've been talking to people that have been on, someone that's been on too early on, way back when I started this. Somebody's gonna be coming back on, so stay tuned for that. Maybe a little surprise for you guys. Get some new guests coming on and all that. Make sure you like, subscribe, share, and all that good stuff. Hit the notification bell so you know when new episodes drop. I'd love to hear your feedback as well in the comment section. You got any questions for me related to my other videos about anxiety topics, more serious topics, or if you want to give your comment on something Mike and I said to you about the game, I'll leave that below. You hit me up online. You can find Mike on Facebook and Twitter. If you want to say anything to him, go check him out at the Daily Press in Akron, 323 South Main Street, across from Canal Park Cocktail Lounge. Go check him out. And, yeah, have a good rest of the week, guys. Stay warm if you're in the snow. And I'll be going out in it still. But, I'll see you guys in the next one. I'm out of here.